this is part of a process, and if we can get the concept right and get a critical mass of people really just not only discussing it in venues like this but on social media, etc., I like to think we can roll this out to different parts of the country, because ultimately it's not just a London problem, it is a national problem. So I'm going to pick on my ex-colleague to start the ball rolling. As you already know, Chris is a serving officer, and he's very active on Twitter. I watch him really addressing some really critical issues. And normally, police officers are very risk-averse to be on social media. And I must admit, I was one of the few who used to Twitter when I was still in the organisation up to 4 years ago. So I'm really impressed that you actually are doing that. So I just want to give you an opportunity, and hopefully there's a microphone near you, to give your view as an operational officer, and also in the wider debate around these issues.
Thanks very much, Leroy. I think from working at TSG, I experienced quite a bit of dissatisfaction when, you know, working out on the front line, especially with young people and serious violence. And I remember when I sort of said to myself, is there anything we could do to perhaps better get people's trust, not just young people, but communities as well? So on a local level, I've done some engagement with, in particular, 16 to 19 year olds, and literally focus on going into schools and talking to people and getting their opinions about stop and search and perhaps how we can do things better, as well as informing them about what they can expect from us in terms of a service. And that seemed to have a really sort of positive impact, and I wish we could do more with it. But for such a big organisation, I think sometimes we manage expectations, and I'm really about doing stuff rather than talking about it to a degree. So I think so far I've tried to do with me and my colleagues what we can do on a local level, but to be part of something like this is a really interesting and exciting prospect, and I hope to be able to give a little bit of a perspective. I want to say from my side, not necessarily, nobody sent me here from the Met, if that makes sense. I'm just Chris today. But with a little bit of experience, I'd like to sort of, I suppose, give my two pence and take on board and perhaps take back some of the ideas and solutions that we might come up with today. So thank you very much.
I think the murder rate is actually going down, not because officers are preventing it, but it's these surgeons that turn them round from the brink of death, and sometimes they are flatlining and you bring them back. And, you know, it's amazing how, you know, they can be stabilised in situ in the streets or wherever they are, and then airlifted or through the ambulances to the hospital. It's amazing how they stabilise them in those situations where they hadn't before. And I think that contributes so much to them surviving. But over to you, Duncan.
No, thank you. It's a real pleasure to be here with so many like-minded people, as we said, who quite often we've all met the same children in our own walks of life, but because this is, I haven't met you. We've made a huge difference to the way that we look after patients who've had traumatic injuries over the last few years. We used to see trauma in its isolation as a problem, but we now see it as a disease. In a similar way to that, rather than having multi-specialty hospitals, we have trauma centres that are specialist units to look after trauma patients. We formed networks of care which stretch out into the counties around London, which actually then have groups of people and the teams working with a shared ethos to be able to bring those patients through, particularly with time-critical injuries, so much faster than we did before, and using techniques that we weren't using before through experience from military and civilian partnerships. And I've worked all over the world in civilian, military and NGO, different scenarios with people in extreme violent conflicts and within gangs. And for me, I had quite a formative experience working in Cape Town with the numbers gangs on the Cape Flats. And coming back to London, it's really striking the difference that we've made. We've reduced mortality by up to 30% in some of the really high risk injuries that we see, particularly the time critical injuries. But what we have seen also within that is some increase in patients who are surviving but with actually rehabilitative needs as well. So you have to recognise that we are saving lives, but there also is a need for rehabilitation to get people to their true rehabilitation potential within that. And so we see violence and trauma as a whole as a public health problem, and that needs a public health solution. The children I look after, they want to be loved. They want to feel like they matter. They want to feel that they're cared for and they have status. They want to feel that people respect them. And I think those are values that we all share and would want the same for ourselves and for our children. And I think, but we also have to recognise that the problem within violence is not just shared, it's just for the youth. It's actually within all of us. And we all have a potential for violence given the right environmental conditions and socioeconomic stresses on our lives. And with that, actually, we don't just see young people coming in with these injuries. We see a huge breadth of people coming in from all age ranges, actually. I think we have to be careful that we're not labelling the youth as having just that problem alone. And within that, and seeing it as a public health problem, I think we also have to then reflect, we're talking about as a virus today. I think in some ways, although that's really good to focus on it as a public health problem, it makes it a little bit too simplistic in some ways, perhaps alluding to it being one cause to the problem when it's such a huge multifactorial issue with lots of etiological factors. I think that in a way we have to see violence almost as a systemic problem, which is endemic within society always, and we have to go out there in a public health sense to prevent it from happening. And if we don't, and we have the socioeconomic situations that will lead to it flourishing, then it's almost a certainty rather than something that may happen. So we have to go out there to prevent it. I've been looking at the geospatial analysis of injuries that have been happening around London recently, and see if you overlay the firearms injuries of the last 5 years onto areas of social deprivation, they map perfectly against each other. And therefore poverty and problems they have with socioeconomic factors are a massive driver, as they always have been, towards crime and people being drawn into a cycle of violence and exploitation. So there are key themes that go throughout all this, and many of us all understand that. But how do we get that issue across on the public health agenda in order to be able to save lives? So much as we've collaborated in the success of our trauma networks in terms of everybody singing from the same hymn sheet, to be able to really streamline that, those time-critical injuries, I think there's an opportunity here for us to work together in a very similar way to channel all of the shared energies that we have to try and achieve a common goal, really to make a big difference, not just the physical, but actually particularly the mental well-being of the society of the children that we live in.
The reputation I have is because I was working directly with young people, and have done so since about 1997, 2000, and actually gone into people's homes and worked with families and tried to develop programs that have helped those people I've been working with to get out of that life of violence. That's where my reputation has come from. And some of the programs have worked really well and some of them haven't. But there's a saying which I hold really dearly, which is, it takes good men to do nothing for evil to prevail. And if my belief very strongly is every single person has a role to play in this agenda. It doesn't matter whether you describe yourself as a police officer or a local government officer or someone who's working in a voluntary organisation, or you're in government. We all have a role to play. And where I see the biggest challenge is that it feels to me as if in some parlance, people have turned their eye off this agenda. It feels to me that the conversation around Brexit and big regeneration programs actually has made government impotent over this. So we hear about young people getting injured, getting injured through knife injuries and gunshots, and actually it doesn't feel like it matters at the moment. You know what it really matters? It matters now more than ever before. Because we're going through a stage where if we don't put some of the social support back in that actually has been taken away, we're going to repeat the history that we saw back in the 70s and the 2000s. So I want to put a challenge back out there around, people talk about big physical regeneration programs. Where is the funding that goes back into voluntary organizations and youth centers and young people to give them genuine choices and opportunities? And the fact of the matter is, feels as if it's stopped. So if you want solutions, let's put something real back in at a community level that actually people on the ground can buy into and feel that they've got a stake and they want to move on. Not just keep on talking around the big picture stuff, when actually on the ground it's the small things that people are seeing disappearing and that's making a difference in their lives. And that challenge goes to central government and it goes to local government as well. It's across the board. And if you want people to own this agenda, put some of that investment back in where it's needed most. Thank you.
When I was 16 years old, well, no, I said, yeah, when I was 15, let me start there. My childhood friend, a good friend of mine I grew up with, was shot and killed a month before his 18th birthday. And when I was 16, so a year later, I set up the Forefront Project. It wasn't originally called that, but I'm going to go with that for today. So we're a social enterprise and working with young people around understanding and reducing serious youth violence. And I want to go back because I always used to start my story like that, and for a long time I did. But once I'd started doing this work, after a few years, when I dug a little deeper, I realised that if we only look at violence, serious youth violence, in isolation, aside from other forms of violence, we're really not going to get anywhere. And I think this is the main problem. I thought that my relationship with violence and my experiences of violence started really with the murder of my friend when I was 15. But when I dug a little deeper, I realised that actually I've been surrounded by serious violence my whole life. And I think this is the violent environment that I want to describe to you, because this is the reality for many young people growing up, and not just in London, but many other cities today as well. And so, first of all, poverty is the biggest form of violence, because it creates an environment where other forms of violence can thrive. I witnessed domestic violence in my house. I witnessed domestic violence in the houses of my friends. There was not one young woman that I grew up with that wasn't a victim of sexual violence. I myself was assaulted so many times as a teenager, but when I was an adult, I didn't even realise this, because ultimately I was so desensitised and so detached. I could go and do talks nationally about violence, but I detached it completely from myself as a coping mechanism, because it's difficult to realise that we are so... that violence is so normal to us. And when I started to understand that, I realised this is the context that we have to understand the young people that are involved in serious violence. We can't detach it from that. I have not worked with one young man who didn't grow up with domestic violence in his house. And it's these early childhood experiences that are really informing the behaviour, and I've not seen much work that's trying to address that. I became aware of the ACE study, the Adverse Childhood Experiences study, not that long ago, but it does talk about how early childhood trauma is going to have effects on the developing brain, especially in the region of stress, the stress and fear response system in our body, how we understand and perceive conflict, the expectation of conflict. Young men that are going out there that are constantly fearful, they're constantly anxious, this is how they perceive their environment. And I don't, I understand exactly why they carry weapons, because you don't want to be caught without one if everybody else is going to have one. And ultimately that is what is driving it. I started talking a lot about why we need to stop using the idea of a gang, because gangs doesn't help us explain that violence. In reality, it doesn't. It's just going to deter us, because we're not going to get to the root. I want to see more work done around mental health. I've been saying this for so long. There's not one young person I know that's had any interaction with the mental health services. They've seen things that they can't unsee, things that the majority of people will never see in their lives, things that people could not imagine seeing and would not be able to cope or deal with if you did see. I know young people that have watched their friend die in front of them. They've not been given any support for that. And that got me thinking about post-traumatic stress disorder and things like that. And I thought, this is quite poignant, because if we could actually start to understand trauma and start to give kind of therapeutic interventions that deal with that and work with young people holistically, then perhaps we'd get somewhere. But I'm now of the, you know, now I'm even considering that and thinking that's not even far enough. Because when I really, really thought about it, we don't live post-trauma. It's not post-traumatic stress. Last week, let me just use that as an example, I cried several times. Doing this work is one thing that it means I'm always close to it, but I cried several times because I'm not detached from it myself. It's very close to me. There were 2-3 incidents, 2 people were killed. I cried when I saw that Jojo had been killed. I cried when I saw Kumari had been killed. These are 19-year-olds, 15-year-olds. And then I found out that 2 of my childhood friends had been charged with murder. This all happened in the space of a week. We don't even have time to heal or breathe, let alone heal, before the next incident. So we don't live post-trauma. We live in what I'm calling perpetual community trauma. It's never ending. And I think even mental health interventions that deal with individuals aren't going to be enough. We need something that collectively deals with community trauma. That entire communities are traumatized, and that we're just left every time we look at the TV, it just re-traumatizes us with every another young person that is killed. So I think that is the type of work I think needs to be done in this country. And I think until we really start to look at it like that, I don't believe we're going to get very far. Thank you.
Now, we know that lots of young people are carrying weapons now who aren't involved in drug dealing. And I think most of us would probably agree that the reason for that is because young people feel afraid. They feel afraid to go out on the streets, and so they're carrying weapons. We've created a situation where we're almost guaranteeing that a large group of young people is going to be carrying weapons because they're involved in drug dealing. So for me, it's no surprise that other young people who aren't involved are also feeling afraid. It kind of, there's a link into what's going on social media as well, but I'll probably come back to that at some point. The other big thing is the criminalisation of young people. So if we look at the stats from last year, 2016, one in four youth cautions were for drug offences. If we look at the, I think stop and searches, it was 60% are related to the police looking for drug possession or drug supply. If we look at the youth custody estate, and this is coming on to another problem, which is the disproportionate representation of black or minority ethnic young people in drug offences. We see that there's, for young people who are in the youth estate who are white, it's 4% in there for drug offences, but it's over triple that for young people from black and minority ethnic communities. If we look at some London-based stats, for example, in Lewisham, I think one in four of every proven offences against a young person from a black or minority ethnic background is a drug offence, whereas for white people, it's one in 13. If we go to Hackney, it's one in three, whereas for white people, it's one in nine. So there's a disproportionate impact of young people from black and minority ethnic backgrounds. Now, there's something strange going on with those stats, because we know from surveys that when young people report whether they're likely to use drugs or deal with them, there's not a huge difference between on the basis of ethnic background about whether they're going to be dealing or using drugs. So what is happening with those stats in the criminal justice system? One of the allegations is that police target certain communities. Now, I don't have a particular problem with that one. It seems pretty obvious to me that that happens. I only have to look back at my own experience of going to Sheffield University and my halls of residence, predominantly white and middle class. Drug supply and use went on every single day in those halls of residence, and yet I didn't see one police officer ever in those halls of residence. There were no stop and searches, no charges, no convictions, nothing. So, again, war on drugs, fundamentally flawed. It produces violence because it takes regulation out of the courts and puts it, instead we get regulation by violence. And three, it criminalises young people, which, as we know, stops young people from progressing in life, and it makes them more likely to commit offences. So I would say, on top of all the things that people have already been raising, which are also very important, I think trauma is also going to be another big one that we're going to be focusing on. The war on drugs is also an important issue that we need to be looking at.
I have the privilege of chairing the independent advisory group for Lambeth Police, but I also chair the Lambeth Safer Neighbourhood Board, so I sometimes have a little bit of a split personality conflict, because on one hand I'm supposed to be a community critical advisor, a best friend to the local police, but at the same time I'm holding them to account on their performance, particularly around engagement with young people. And Chris has picked up on the importance of improving young people's confidence in police, particularly around stop and search and other aspects of policing which affect them. For me, I've long felt that violence, particularly affecting young people, is a public health issue. In fact, London Borough of Lambeth some years ago published a very effective needs assessment which recognised that. But like many local government and central government processes and initiatives over the years, we've had glossy report after glossy report after glossy report, and they simply sit in trays gathering dust. I served for a while as a member of the community on the Metropolitan Police Service's own Corporate Children and Young People Board, a board which was unhelpfully wound up shortly before the Olympics, simply because policing priorities had taken a different direction. That board was instrumental in publishing a really robust strategy for the way in which young people were to be policed across London. It never really saw the light of day. The comprehensive delivery plan that was associated with it was never implemented. And this is perhaps endemic when we reach out to local and central government to try and find the solutions for the problems that we're talking about. We know what the problems are. We're all experts in what the problems are. We've been too reliant for too long on local and central governments to try and deliver the solutions. Everything is tied to short-term political timetables, and you can't stop serious youth violence in 5 years. It's probably a generational piece of work, if not longer. Information sharing is something which has always concerned me. If we're treating violence as a virus, then everyone needs to be aware of the symptoms and the treatment, and there are too many barriers to sharing information. I've sat in many meetings where the statutory partners have been reluctant to impart information, intelligence, about heightened tensions between groups of young people in this borough. If that information was shared more widely, particularly with practitioners in the community and voluntary sector, there's more chance of effective intervention. There's more chance of community-led resolution. We also need to tap in more effectively to the moral voice of the community. This borough and a couple of other boroughs had imposed upon them by the Mayor's Office for Policing and Crime something called Operation Shield, which was all about gang intervention, offering those involved in negative lifestyles effective ways out. It's worked in various places in America. It's also failed in various places of America. But in order for anything like that to be successful, it has to have the strong moral voice of the community firmly behind it. And I'm very passionate in believing that it's only if the community takes leadership here over a sustained period of time, adequately supported by central government and appropriate funding, that we'll actually start to deliver the long-lasting solutions that are needed to deal with the scourge of violence in our communities. I've just, as on my way in, I was talking to one of the security guards here, who was first on scene stabbing, in fact, violent attack by car and then stabbing of an 18-year-old virtually outside this building a few days after Christmas. I've also seen the body-worn video from one of the police officers who was at the scene, as those two police officers, the bouncer from here and a passing off-duty medic, struggled for 27 minutes to preserve the life of that young man before paramedics and the ambulance service were able to attend. And I pay massive tribute to Duncan and his colleagues for what they do in terms of reducing the death rate of those young people that find their way into the accident and emergency sections. Young black men are disproportionately represented both as victims and as perpetrators. And it's too easy, as Jonathan said, to simply point at young men as being the drivers of crime. We also mustn't forget violence as it affects young women. We've got to treat those two issues equally importantly. But I think the work we're trying to develop in Lambeth, which is more cohesive working between the community and voluntary sector and the statutory partners, is going to be key for the long term. The perversity of the economic issues we've seen over the last few years is you'll find community and voluntary sector organisations working more and more in isolation, in competition with each other, scared to share data, simply because they're competing for the same ever-diminishing pots of money. We've got to push aside those issues. We've got to work more cohesively together. And I genuinely feel that if we can do so, we know what the problems are. We just need to deliver those solutions. But we must also not lose sight of the fact that young people have a voice in this, and young people need to be involved in helping us form those solutions. Thank you.